everybody. It's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and we wanted to show you our first harvest of the year. Zucchinis. These are those tiny giants that we had from over there, which are not tiny. And these are our two first actual big tomatoes. This is Sunset's Red. What did I tell you this was? Sunset's Red Velvet, perhaps. This is a heirloom. And then this is a striped Roma, which is also an heirloom. These are wonderful. We've had these before. Today is probably and hopefully the hottest day of the year, and they won't be this hot anymore. While it's only 88 degrees out, the dew point is almost 70 degrees Fahrenheit, which is 21 degrees Celsius. That means that it is just oppressive out here. Thank goodness there's a cloud cover, but you just can't walk out and you're totally wet already.
And I'm amazed they're still finally roofing the back section of
that
new house they've been renovating.
Yes. It's, thank goodness, part of it is in the shade, so I'm guessing that's why they can do it. I hope they're taking lots of breaks and drinking lots of liquids. Well, I came out here because I knew this tomato was going to be ready. But then I saw that just in the last 2 days, the tomatoes, because of the heat, and then each night we've been getting some rain, they are going crazy again, and they are jumping out of their cages. So while they're still pliable, I wanted to get them back in their cages, do a little trimming, and I wanted to do it before it got to be 94 degrees in the shade.
94, it's supposed to be 110 today.
Well, that's the feels like temperature.
Yeah, well, yeah. That's...
So that's why we can't stay out here very long.
Yeah.
But what I'm talking about is I'm just putting these guys back in their cages. As you can see, the sides are coming out. If I don't get them today and it gets cooler and then suddenly they're growing too fast and I can't, they're not pliable enough to bend back in. Like this guy, unfortunately, I didn't get it soon enough. And while that is a sucker, it's a nice healthy sucker. So I'm just gonna have to leave this guy until he gets a little bigger and I can stuff him back up in here. But I just want
a nice cool breeze.
That is a nice breeze. I just want to make sure if I can still get them in. Also, I'm checking in the middle to see if I have too many leaves in here because I want to have circulation down the middle.
Well, I noticed over in that back one you have another tomato.
Yes, and look at this guy.
Oh,
this is a nemesis right there. Good. Fly away and don't come back. That's a Japanese beetle. Not good.
Oh, here he comes back again.
Okay, so I'm just getting these guys in. Now see, this is a perfect example. This one. While they're still pliable like that, I can move them and get them back inside the cage.
Well, that makes it so much easier come picking time, too.
Oh, definitely. Yes.
Otherwise, they're all over the place.
Yes. Well, and then they get in intruding on each other, and it's just not good. Let's see if I can get in here. But see, we don't need that big old leaf right there. And there's leaves down going down in the middle here, so I have to trace it back to the original stem and get rid of it. And that allows the air to flow through, and there's less chance of disease or insects that we don't see because it's so crowded. And then there's one sucker down here I don't want to start. There's another one and another one. I'm also keeping the lower parts of my plant clipped up because I don't want the splashing from the soil to get up on the leaves. That somehow, sometimes you get blight from that, and I'm guessing this is like a late blight that comes from just that very thing, splashing. I just cut those off.
I know you mentioned to several viewers that one of the things you want to avoid is the water splashing back up onto the leaves themselves, and so you recommended putting a thin layer of straw or grass clippings or something.
If you're having a problem, yes, that would be a good thing to do. I haven't done it at this point because I haven't had too much problem, and I should get out here and put another dose of powdered milk on here just to prevent any mildew or fungus from growing.
Mold.
And mold, right, that would help. It's just been so warm, and then with rain every night, we are like in the tropics.
Boy.
The tomatoes are loving it.
Would you go on the other side there once and see if that other tomato is ready? I saw one more down there.
Yes.
And this is a what?
And while I'm here, let me get this in here. This is a carnival, right. This is a medium-sized tomato. I've had good luck with it in the past.
Can you bring the sticker up?
Mm-hmm. And let me go get that other one with the sunset's red.
Okay.
Whatever that was that I was.
So is that tomato ready? That's
yep,
down there?
It's ready. It could go a little bit longer, but you see the cracking? That's because we went for a while without any rain, and then suddenly we got rain, so sometimes they crack because they just get so full, it's like a balloon, they want to pop open. This is what I saw.
So we know.
We know we don't have any rabbits, because we have a coyote that is doing a really good job of keeping rabbits down. But unfortunately, the coyotes are not going after the deer because they have enough to eat. And while I don't see any nibbling going on, at least not back here, obviously someone stopped here for a bit.
Maybe I have to put netting up against these posts here.
Well, they're not bothering them though, that's the thing.
That's true.
And while we've got both ends blocked off, there's plenty of ways they can come sideways. Okay, that other tomato was Sunset's Red Horizon. This is a heirloom. Frost-resistant fruits, native Russian. And it's indeterminate, which means...
Now, that was the larger tomato?
That was the large one, right.
You're not sweating, are you?
Yeah, and it's going in my eyeballs.
Yes.
It always hurts. So that's what we've been doing. The other thing I was doing when I harvested the zucchini this morning, I noticed that I needed to put a few more pieces of dill in there just as a protector against the squash bugs. So gotta go finish that. On the way over to the squash, we just had to stop here. It's just listening to the water makes you cooler. There are four water lilies blooming today.
And the fifth one is about to open.
Yep.
Right down here.
Mm-hmm. Now those other two that we see, are those the ones that are done?
No, those are coming up. And then there's another one over here, which will be coming up also. I'd say they're doing extremely well.
They're happy.
Okay, let's go over to the squash.
Okay, I've got to go in the back way.
Okay. I'll meet you over there.
Okay. Now, I may have mentioned this before, but one of the ways that we have been using for a couple of years is to take dill. And we planted dill once and let it go to seed, and now it's everywhere. We take the dill in any form, whether it's blooming like this or not blooming, and I put it right down at the base of any squash. I put it right at the roots, which makes me see that there's another little zucchini there, but I think it's too small. It seems, there's no scientific proof of this, that it disguises the smell of the squash from the squash bugs. and it at least slows them down, if nothing else. And you get a longer crop duration. Now, I know a friend of mine who has her own farm just waits a bit longer to plant her squash, and by the time that they are ready, the squash bug is already done with its life cycle. So that would be another thing to research, but I haven't done that yet.
Well, let's go over to the newly planted flower garden.
Let's do it. Before we go over to our little pretty garden area, we have forgotten we promised to show how our ginkgo cuttings are doing. Now, the first ones we did that we dug up the side shoots off of the tree are absolutely doing wonderfully. I don't think they could be happier.
Yeah.
Then here is another one that we took at the same time, I believe, wasn't it? Or was this the second one?
No, I don't know.
I don't know either, but I think that one's doing all right. Also, these were the ones that we planted from seed from our neighbor's tree. See it? There's three of them in there.
Yeah, they're doing really well.
And this is the one we did the other day. Now, this was a lot larger than the first one, and we had to do a lot of sawing, and it was rough on it. So while the bottom doesn't look too bad, the top is still a little
leafy.
Right, so we'll see. Hopefully it'll perk up once this weather cools down a little bit. That could be the problem. Certainly has gotten enough moisture, so that can't be a problem.
Well, if need be, we could try cutting it back too, and
we could
see what happens.
Yeah, we'll give it a little chance though. We've harmed it enough already.
And while we're at it, we were busy yesterday experimenting with Daphne.
Right. This we cut off a bunch of things that needed trimming anyway and put root hormone on it and put them in the ground. So we'll see how those do. Have no idea if it'll work or not work, but
As long as we're here, let's go out and look at that. Was that the smart weed you said?
Yes, that's smart weed.
I want people to see the damage that the Japanese beetles do, not that they don't already know, but look at these leaves.
Well, we know from the past years that they really like this plant, and this is a really strong plant that is, it'll come back. There is no problem with it, but you can see there are Japanese beetles all over the place on it. As long as they go to this one and stay off, which they're not, but if they go to the smartweed and leave my hibiscus alone, I'll be happy. This is what the smartweed looks like when nobody's chewing on it.
And you just shoot out about a dozen Japanese beetles. Because
right.
Because they're already working down
there. Oh, they're
here
all
on
over.
This.
And there's two mating.
Yeah. Gee, just what we need.
They are awful. Well, if you look over there, there's three of them right in a bunch.
Yeah.
But go ahead, eat these. This is a baby off of that one. They propagate easily by themselves, so.
And look at your clematis is going for a second round already.
Yep, starting all over again.
That is an amazing plant.
Yeah, look at all those buds up at the top.
Yeah, considering this plant did nothing for decades.
Years and years.
Okay, let's finally get over to that new flower garden area.
Okay. When we were putting these plants in, some of them we bought on sale, which, and this is a great time for buying annuals on sale. We weren't sure what these were. They're so beautiful, but we weren't sure. And thank you to Tim from Upper Michigan. He told us these are miniature petunias called Calabracho. Calabrachoa. We're not good at our pronunciations. We're really happy with how this is turning out. That is tickweed. Thank you. That planted itself in there. These, we're not sure what they are. They might be Peruvian sunflowers or sundrops. We're going to see. But those were in there already. Then we have, of course, the sunflower, the miniature sunflowers, and regular petunias and geraniums and marigolds. So I think it'll turn out really well. Some of you asked about the liatris and does it always grow straight up? And if it doesn't, will it uncurl? No, it will not. For whatever reason, this particular group of liatris every year is curly. It has its own way of growing, and it will bloom in this
shape.
Obviously, it looks like it's not blooming as spectacularly as its neighbors next door, but you know, each one has its own little mini climate that it's in. Maybe it doesn't like the shade from the tree. Maybe something is chewing on its roots. Who knows? Guess what I saw on our Queen of the Prairie?
No.
Yes. Japanese beetles like the blossoms.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
I have to go over. I was very impressed when I saw this plant growing here.
Mm-hmm. Well, we planted it a couple years ago, and this is the first year that it's ever bloomed. Mm. And several times when I've been out here with Jingle, they have been in right in the blossomy part. They don't seem to like the part that's done blossoming already. They like the one that's still blossoming. Mm. Haven't been a whole lot on the leaves, though, although there is some damage. But, you know, there's nothing you can do about them.
Now, several viewers ask about iris when there are spots on them or the leaves are brown.
Yes. Probably means that you have iris borer. And the only thing you can do about that is take those out, trim them off, clean them up as much as possible.
You're talking about the tubers?
The tubers, right. And just plant them someplace else. At this point, you could chop all of yours off and leave, you know, like a 10-inch or 6-inch leaf stem, a leaf height.
So just cut the fans in half.
You could. You could. I usually don't unless there's a problem. And, you know, even as I look over there, I see some that seem to be having a problem, not as badly as the ones in my other area, but I will be pulling those out and cleaning them up and moving those particular ones.
Well, I know you mentioned that you have several shout-outs that you'd like to give.
I do. And I'm going to do it in the shade. First of all, Nicole Bellamy, she and her parents, Cam and Todd, watch us from Columbia, Canada. And she had a special request for her mom, whose birthday is on the 29th. It's for us to say, happy birthday, Cam.
Happy birthday, Cam.
And since next week we're going to be kind of busy with Rick's surgery and all, we wanted to make sure we got it in before her birthday happened.
Well, I'm hopeful that I'll be able to continue to produce videos between now and the end of August as
you
I go
will.
Through two rounds. Everybody reassures me
yes.
Things are going to go fine. I'm going to see much clearer. I might even see what you actually look like.
You might. Maybe you'll be shocked. You'll be able to see all my wrinkles now.
Aww.
We also wanted to give a shout out. We have a whole happy shout out list here to Manukas. Who's from Portugal. I hope I'm saying your name right. If I'm not, please forgive me. He is a passionate 16-year-old gardener from Portugal, and he introduced us after seeing our calla lilies, to a very large species that he's familiar with.
So we're going to research that.
Yeah, we're going to research. And it comes, he said, in white and in green, and it's called, now please bear with me, Xanthadicia atypica. Bad. I never did take Latin. But thank you for that, Manukas. We will check on those. They sound wonderful. We'd also like to commend Ferruccio. Who is doing very well conversing with us in English. Obviously, we are not doing well conversing with him.
Well, I think you mentioned that. We're still learning the English language ourselves.
We are. Then we'd like to thank Frugal Cat, who has been watching us for for years and years, because they identified that
mystery plant
that looks like cannabis, but it isn't. It's called sulfur chinquefoil, and according to them, it's a noxious invasive weed.
Well, I actually went online to double check, and you know, we try to confirm things,
right.
And sure enough, it came up as a very invasive and noxious weed.
Yes.
So we immediately unplanted it.
It has 7 leaves, unlike cannabis. And I know every year I pull it up from the same exact place, so there must still be some root in there that causes it to come back every year. So I've faithfully pulled it out every year. We just want to thank our viewers. You guys are so wonderful, helping us figure out what we have, what problems we have, tips that you can give us. Just watching every year, every time we give a video, and supporting us in every way.
Well, I know you said Gayla too was, and Portia, and so many others. I mean, my goodness, the list goes on and on.
Yes.
You know, you should go to wisconsingarden.com, and at the top, there's something called viewer comments. If you want to spend a couple of hours looking at how beautifully and kind,
positive things.
Oh my goodness, we're just blown away at the beautiful comments that people leave on YouTube and elsewhere, and send us personal emails. My goodness,
yes,
something we never expected when we began this video blog. It wasn't even on our radar.
No, and with all the negative comments and
news.
Actions and news. Every day you hear something negative. You guys are just wonderful.
The sweat is rolling off the back of my neck.
We wanted to thank you before we melted, and hope you enjoy our future videos as well.
Well, stay cool, because today is going to be a horrendous day for much of the Midwest and throughout the country as we look at the national weather. And I think even Manicus from Portugal.
I want to say Manicus.
Manicus. He had mentioned too that it was already 110 over there.
Yes. Yes. And, you know, we're just not used to this kind of weather in Wisconsin.
It's the humidity.
It often gets, you know, really hot and humid in Wisconsin, but it doesn't last as long, and it doesn't quite get this hot. At least when you're a kid, you think it did. As you were waiting to jump into the swimming pool, but as adults, it's harder. If you enjoyed this video, and you forgive us for misnaming you and pronouncing it incorrectly, please give us a thumbs up. We hope you stay cool. We love your comments and questions. And if you'd like to become part of our garden family, that little button right there that says subscriber, real tiny little thing, you can just subscribe to us right there. Thanks again. Stay cool. Into the house we go.
Shower number 2 of the day. I'm sure that won't be our last.
Connect with us on YouTube.